Well, good morning. I'm so grateful that you've joined with us today. We are continuing today with this series entitled The Awfulness of Lostness. Today, we're going to look at the importance that the Bible puts upon praying for those that we love, those that we know. In fact, the Bible tells us we need to pray for those we don't know, from those in great positions down to those that are like you and me, the everyday person. Prayer is important. I remember as a child hearing a pastor say, "Much prayer is much power. Little prayer is little power. And no prayer is no power." Today, I hope we will make a commitment to pray. Pray for yourself. That's not selfish. That's sensible. But let's remember to pray for others. In fact, let's pray together right now. Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity that we have to come before your throne, the throne of grace and the throne of all power. Father, I pray, Lord, today that you would bless every home in which this recording is being watched today as we worship together over the internet. Father, I am thankful that here at Yulee Baptist, we are also able to meet freely so that we can gather together in accordance with your word. And now, Father, I pray for every person, whether worshiping at home because of the pandemic or worshiping here. Father, help us, Lord, to make a commitment today in 2021 to be a people of prayer that you've called us to be. And we pray these things in the wonderful and powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Hear the heart of heaven beating. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Hear the hush of mercy breathing. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Hear the host of angels sing. Glory to the newborn King, and the sounding joy repeating. Jesus saves. The humblest hearts adore him. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. And the wisest bow before him. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. See the sky alive with praise, melting darkness in its place. There is light forevermore in Jesus' saves. He will live our sorrow sharing. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. He will die our burden bearing. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. It is done, we'll shout the cross. Christ has paid redemption's cost. While the empty tomb's declaring, Jesus saves. Falling, hope is dawning, bright and true. Day is breaking and night is quaking. God is making all things new. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor Jesus saved. Together. redemption song. The redeemed will sing forever.
Well, as I mentioned in the opening, we are continuing in the Awfulness of Lostness sermon series. And I'm so thankful for John Michael singing that tremendous song, which is a wonderful opening to this message because it emphasizes the importance of reaching those who do not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And what a powerful message and song that is. Today, we are looking at this message entitled, Praying for the Lost. We're going to look together at a scripture verse, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Read on the screen with me as I read these verses out loud. Here, the Word of God says, I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. Let's pray again. Father, we come again after reading the scripture passage before you. Father, we come before you in prayer, asking that you will speak to our hearts. Father, through prayer, help us to be in line with your will and your word. And now, Father, I pray that every person that is worshiping today by joining with us here at Yulee Baptist Church Online, Father, that you will speak to our hearts. Help us, Lord, to know your will in accordance with this scripture that we have just read. And Father, help us to get in line with your word and do your will. Father, I also pray that we will be committed to pray your word. Father, help us to learn how to pray the scripture, that we will join with you, that you are a God who would have all to be saved. Father, you're a God who would have us to live holy lives, and a God who would have us to live in accordance with your will and your word. Help us to learn these things even today. And we pray this in the wonderful and the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Well, let me begin with a story that I remember using when I was leading Sunday schools as a minister of education. I would read this in connection with our Sunday school classes. Right now, because of the pandemic, many churches are not able to meet. Many Sunday school classes are still not meeting on a regular basis. But this story applies not only to Sunday school classes. I believe it applies to churches. It applies to homes. And I believe it applies to individuals. Let me share this with you. It's called the life-saving station. On a dangerous seacoast where shipwrecks often occur, stood a life-saving station. The building was just a hut, and there was only one boat. But the few dedicated members kept constant watch over the sea, with no thought for themselves. They went out day and night tirelessly, searching for those that might be lost at sea because of a shipwreck. Many of those who had been rescued also came and joined with the club. And they would work around the surrounding areas. And many people saw the life-saving work and desired to come and join with them. They gave their time, they gave their money and their efforts to support the work of the little life-saving station. New boats were bought and crews were trained, and the life-saving station grew. In time, some of the crew became concerned that the life-saving station was crude and poorly equipped, and so they wanted better facilities so that it would be a wonderful place of refuge for those who were rescued from the sea. The emergency cots that were secondhand were replaced with nice new beds, and better furniture was purchased for an enlarged building. The station then became a popular gathering place for its members, and so they decorated the life-saving station with beautiful ornaments. Fewer members were now interested in actually leaving the nice station and going out to do the work of saving people from being capsized or for accidents that occurred out at sea. So they would hire other people to take their place. And they still retained the life-saving motif, but the truth is there weren't as many people really interested in going out and helping to save those who had been lost. One dark, stormy night, a large ship was wrecked off the coast, and the hired crews brought in lifeboats filled with cold, wet, half-drowned people. They were dirty and sick, and some had come from distant shores, and the station was in chaos. The event was so traumatic that the people decided to build outhouses where those who were dirty and wet could come, so they didn't upset the club. So they didn't dirty up the beds and the furniture. Well, eventually, there came a split in the station. Many of the members wanted to discontinue the work of staying open to help those that were lost at sea. Some didn't like the fact that there were people in the building that weren't like them. They said there were too many people in the building, and they were dirty, and they came in wet from the sea. They saw that as a hindrance to the life of the club. However, some in the life-saving club insisted that their job was to rescue those who were lost at sea, and so a split occurred. And the minority who wanted to continue the work of saving others left the station and went and built a new station. But over time, they were ignored at the new station too, because it went through the same process of attracting people that wanted to come because they enjoyed the fellowship. But they didn't want to go out anymore to help those and rescue the perishing. Yes, today if you went to that seacoast, you'll find a number of impressive looking buildings that say life-saving station. Sadly, shipwrecks still occur in those waters, but most people die because there's no one that really wants to go out and do the work of bringing in the lost at sea. Well, that little illustration reminds me of the many churches that no longer see their task as being the work of going out into the community and bringing in the lost. Churches that are not committed to remaining open and doing the work of being prepared so that those who are lost can come in and find the help that they need. Yes, unfortunately, many churches have become clubs instead of life-saving stations. Well, the church at Ephesus, where Timothy was the pastor, had long been a beacon of light to their community in the world. But the church had moved away from its mission of going out and telling others about Jesus. Instead, they were more interested in fellowship and arguing about the doctrines that had been made clear from the Word of God already. Because only the life-saving gospel can change a life, the church needed to be called back to their original purpose. So Paul is writing this book that we find in the Bible to bring the focus of the church back to the job of reaching out with the gospel message to a world. You see, Paul had once been the pastor at the church at Ephesus, and now a younger pastor named Timothy was the pastor at the church at Ephesus. And Paul was saying, you know, it doesn't matter what the majority of the people think. Timothy, you're the pastor, and you need to lead the church to be open and to go out and to share the gospel message. And I would say today that if there's a word that needs to be shared with churches across America, it's that we must get back to our purpose that God established us to be. A life-saving station, sharing the gospel, remaining open, and going out into our communities and telling the lost that there is a way of salvation in this age of hopelessness. You see, these verses are instructions for the church to pray for the lost. And if there's ever been a time that the church needs to pray for those who don't know the wonderful saving gospel message of Jesus Christ, it is now. Well, let's look, first of all, at the priority of prayer. Look at what the Word of God says. I exhort, therefore. The Bible places an emphasis on the importance of praying for the lost in these words from our text. One of the key words in this entire text is the word exhort. It is the Greek word parakaleo, which parakaleo, para means to come alongside with, and kaleo means to be called. And so this is a call to be alongside with and to pray to the God who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. This means all people. Every man, every woman, every teenager, every boy or girl needs to know the gospel message. They need to hear the gospel call to be saved from their sin. And yes, that's a good Bible word, saved. Did you see what our text says in verse 4? Our God who will have all people to be saved. They need to be saved from the penalty of sin, the eternal penalty of being separated from a holy God. They need to be saved from the power of sin that binds them and keeps them in horrible lifestyles and habits. And one day, they will need to be saved from the very presence of sin. And so, God has given us this call to come alongside with Him in prayer and in practice to share the gospel with a lost world. This is a strong word, exhort, to come along with God in this effort. The church at Ephesus had forgotten their priority to pray for the lost. And because of that, they were no longer reaching the lost the way God would have them to do it. I am concerned about the modern church today because I believe we have lost the priority of praying for the lost. I remember a time in a church many, many years ago, in fact, decades ago, when the altar call would be given and people would come and kneel and pray and even cry, because they were burdened for the lost in their family, burdened for the lost in the community, and even burdened for the lost people they did not even know in the world. Let me share with you the story of John Stott, longtime pastor in London, who tells of visiting a church when he was on vacation himself. He says, the pastor of the church that he went to was absent on holiday, and a lay elder led the pastoral prayer. He prayed that the senior pastor might enjoy a good vacation, which was fine. And then he prayed that two lady members of the congregation might be healed from a sickness. And that is also fine, and in fact, it's biblical. We should pray for the sick. But that was all. The intercession could hardly have lasted 30 seconds. There was no recognition of the needs of the world and no attempt to embrace the world in prayer. In Dr. Richard Blackaby's book on spiritual leadership, he says, the single most important thing leaders should do is to pray. One pastor said, you know, if I announce a banquet at the church, the church will be filled with people who want to come for dinner on the grounds. But if I announce a special prayer meeting for those in our community that are lost, I'm lucky if the ushers will show up or even the deacons. Yulee Baptist, perk up your ears, because nothing of eternal significance will happen apart from the power of God. We need the power of God in our lives, in our homes, in our church, and in our nation. Listen, if God doesn't show up to save the city, according to the Word of God, then the watchman watches in vain. It is important that we watch and that we work, but it is also important that we pray, because without the power of God, there will be no evangelistic efforts that will bear fruit. There will be no efforts to disciple those who are saved without the power of prayer that draws the new believer to continue in their journey of faith. Listen, we need the power of God. The failure of most churches is a failure to believe by faith in prayer. We say we believe in prayer, but do we? If we did, I believe the altar would be filled with people praying for this community, praying that the doors of the church would be open to those that would come in. No wonder the Bible records these important opening words in our text. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, do you see that first of all? There is a priority to praying for the lost, in addition to praying for other things. Well, second, we see a pattern for prayer in this passage. He says, first of all, that's the first thing I want you to notice about this pattern. It needs to take priority. And then he says, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men or for all people. Paul lists different types of prayer that are to be offered to the Lord. The Lord, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. Do you see what kind of God we have? Our pattern of prayer is to join with Him who would have all people to be saved. Now, the word supplication is a kind of prayer that arises from a felt need. The root meaning is to lack or to be deprived or to be without. And so we are praying, we are asking God. It can also be translated request. We are making request unto God because of a lack of something, and that's okay. But I believe in this passage, what the church was lacking was a heart for the lost, a heart for those who were going about their life without any thought of God, who were not joining in worship, who were not even worshiping at home. They were going about life as if God did not really exist. Supplication. Listen, there is a great need. You may have a need in your life today. I want you to know that supplications or requests are fine for your needs. And if you're watching today and you have a physical need, maybe you have a sickness, I encourage you, please call me. I'm going to give my phone number out later, 904-226-5547. I encourage you to call, that we might pray together about your need. And that's okay. I encourage that. I want to pray with you about your physical needs. It could be a financial need. It could be a need in your family or some other heartfelt need. Maybe you'd like to call me and pray about a lost friend or a lost family member. I want you to know, it would thrill my heart to pray with you about that as well, because I believe that's the context of this text. Well, second, the word prayer emphasizes that our requests, our supplications, are being made to a holy God. We're not just talking amongst one another. So often we say, well, we prayed for you. What that meant is we talked amongst ourselves. No, prayer is not simply talking amongst ourselves. Prayer is talking to a holy God. Do you understand that in prayer, we are going before the throne of the God who created all things? In this passage, God is literally instructing us to offer prayer for all people, for the great and for the small. What does that mean? That means we need to pray for the President of the United States. We need to pray for those in Congress. We need to pray for those in positions of power. You know, when I look at our Baptist Faith and Message, it calls us to pray for leaders of business and leaders in society, and that's biblical. That's exactly what this scripture is telling us. Now, the Greek word intercessions convey the idea of drawing close to your Heavenly Father to converse confidentially with Him about the needs of others. You see, when we are talking with God about the needs of others, hopefully that will help us to keep our mouth shut about talking about others with people in gossip. Listen, this idea of intercessions, it suggests an intimate relationship with God so that we might be able to pray for others. I want to ask you a question. Do you have that kind of intimate relationship with God? Do you have a close relationship with the Lord? The idea of intercessions includes praying for others, but it also means to have a close relationship with the Lord. And I hope you can honestly say that you have a close relationship with God. If you don't, that is your greatest need. Believer, if you're not walking close with the Lord, that is your greatest need today. And I hope that the Holy Spirit will convict you of that. And if you're watching today and you do not know for certain that if you were to die, you'd go to heaven, you need to receive Christ as your Savior. And I hope that pride would not stand in the way of you receiving Christ and having that close relationship that God wants with you. Well, another word that describes prayer and the posture of prayer is that of thanksgiving. This idea of giving thanks is not referring to giving thanks for all the blessings God has given to you, although that's fine. And we ought to thank God for the blessings that He has given to us. No, this thanksgiving is the gratitude that we need to express for having the privilege of going before our God. And again, I want to express that we ought to give thanks that because of a close relationship with the Lord, we can go before Him in prayer and talk to our Heavenly Father, the Creator of this universe. Let me share with you that praying for the lost is biblical. In Numbers 14:19, Moses prayed for those who needed to repent and be saved by a holy God. In 1 Samuel chapter 7, verses 3 through 5, Samuel prayed for those who needed to repent and be saved by God. Samuel later said that it would be a sin for him not to pray for those who needed the Lord. 1 Samuel chapter 12, verse 23 says, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray. If you have ceased to pray, then that's a sin. Did you see what Samuel said? He recognized the fact that not praying is a sin. Stephen prayed for the lost in Acts chapter 7, verses 59 through 60. And Paul prayed for the lost in Romans chapter 10, verse 1. And did you know that our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, prayed for the lost in Luke 23, verse 34. By all means, by all types, we need to pray for our lost family members. We need to pray for our lost friends. And we need to pray for our community that is filled with people who do not know the life-saving gospel of Jesus Christ as taught in the Scripture. Well, third, let's look at the purpose of prayer. That we might lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come into the knowledge of the truth. Let me summarize the purpose in two words: safety and salvation. The first purpose of these prayers, according to Paul, is safety. We need to pray for those in authority that we might be able to have the freedom to lead a quiet and peaceable life. The word quiet here doesn't mean that we're to keep our mouth closed and not share the gospel. The word quiet here means that we have a quiet life. Circumstances around us are not in turmoil. We've seen a lot of turmoil lately. We need to pray for quiet and peaceable lives. Prayer changes things. Sometimes prayer changes other people. Sometimes prayer changes our circumstances. But when we pray, it will always change us. I say that it will sometimes change other people because they have a free will to accept or reject the Lord. We need to pray that they feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit, but we need to remember that God has not failed when they choose to rebel. God wants lost people to be saved. Did you see where it says, who will have? It is God's desire for people to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. And how will they come into the knowledge of truth? There's only one way, my friend. And that's if after we pray, we must go out and share. We live in a day in which we're able to share the gospel over the internet. Just moments before coming to preach this message to you today, someone texted me from another state that has been watching faithfully these videos, worshiping at home where they're locked down and churches are not open. You see, we are able to share using the internet, using our cell phones, texting a message, texting a link to this video. We are able to share by talking to those in our community. And yes, at Yulee Baptist, I am working now on an emphasis in which we will go out door to door and leave information so that people can know the wonderful gospel message. God has given every individual a free will. The salvation of the lost is God's desire, but it is not His decree. Because again, every person can choose to either reject or receive the Lord. And so I want to conclude with this. Will you reject the Word of God today, or will you receive it? Believer, I'm talking to you as well. You may already be saved, but from the preaching of the Word, you have a choice. You can receive what the Holy Spirit has spoken to you today through this message, or you can reject it. I believe preaching to someone that you don't know for certain that if you were to die, you'd go to heaven. And today you have a choice to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior or to reject Him. Let me ask you, do you need to pray today? When was the last time you prayed for that lost family member, that lost neighbor, or for your community, or for the president and others in leadership? We need to pray that the lost will be saved. John Knox was pastor in Scotland, whose famous prayer was, "Lord, give me Scotland or I die." George Whitefield prayed, "O Lord, give me souls or take my soul." He realized that the reason that he was here on this earth was to share the gospel. In fact, the Apostle Paul said this in Romans 10, verse 1, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. And it is my prayer that Yulee Baptist Church will always be a beacon of light in a dark world, a life-saving station to those who need to be rescued from the torment of the sin that they're captured in." Do you need to be forgiven today of sin? Do you need to receive Christ as your Savior? If you do, would you pray and call upon the name of the Lord? Again, the Bible says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." What should you do today? If you have felt the convicting power of the Holy Spirit through this message, first of all, we need to pray and confess sin. 1 John 1, 9 says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Would you pray with me today to receive Christ? Would you ask God to forgive you? David said, "Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I acknowledge my transgressions." Would you pray to receive Jesus into your heart as your Lord and Savior? Jesus said in John 1, 12, "But as many as receive Him, to them gave He the power, the authority to be called the children of God." And if you know for certain that you do have a relationship with God, but you've lost the joy of your salvation, would you pray for God to restore that to you today? Psalm 51, verse 12 says, "Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation." Listen, don't allow the devil to keep you where you're at. If you need to come to the Lord right now, I'd like to have the privilege of leading you in prayer that you might ask God to forgive you of sin and that you might ask the Lord to come into your heart and life, that you will commit to live for Him. You can do that by prayer. Can I lead you in that prayer right now? I'm placing a prayer up on the screen. Would you look at that? I encourage you to come right now to the Lord and then to publicly take your stand for the Lord after you pray to receive Him. If you'd like to ask Christ into your heart, you've been looking at that prayer, I'd like to lead you now in asking Jesus to come into your heart and life, to forgive you of sin, and to be your Lord and Savior. Would you pray after me right now? Dear God, I know that Jesus is your Son and that He died on the cross and was raised from the dead to pay for my sin. I know that I've sinned, and right now I ask forgiveness. Cleanse me from mine iniquity. I am willing to turn away from living for sin, and right now I want to turn and receive Jesus as my Savior and as my Lord. Come into my heart and be the ruler of my life as Lord. Thank you for loving me, and thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now look up here with me. If you haven't heard anything else I've said today, I hope you'll hear this. God loves you, and He wants you to come to Him. Isn't it time? Maybe you're a believer. You've gotten out of the habit of coming to church. You've allowed watching the television or the computer screen to be a substitute for gathering together. If you're out and about, you're going to the restaurants, you're going to the stores, you're going other places, but you're not going to church, I encourage you to come back. If your doctor has told you to stay in, that you're vulnerable, and that you're not going out to these other places, then I'm glad that you can continue to worship online with us. I'm so thankful for this opportunity. I want you to know God loves you. And I know many people are at home right now, and they're wondering, does anybody love me? I want you to know God loves you. I also want you to know I want to make myself available to you as pastor at Yulee Baptist. Feel free to call me. If you prayed that prayer with me to receive Christ, or you're a believer and you're lonely, you've been at home, you're not getting out, you just need somebody to talk to, I invite you to call me right now, 904-226-5547. You can also text me at that number. I also invite you to email me at doug@yuleebaptist.com. You're not alone. God loves you, and I want you to know I'm praying for you. If you have a prayer request, feel free to call me, text me that prayer request. We want to pray. First of all, that's what our passage said. Let's remember to pray. I'd like to pray in closing. Father, as we come to the end of this worship time, Father, I pray for every person that has watched today. Father, I pray for our services on Sunday. Father, I'm thankful for the many that have accepted Christ in these past few weeks. And Father, I pray that you would open our door at Yulee Baptist, that more would come to trust Jesus as their Lord and Savior and to live in accordance with your holy word. Father, be with us this Lord's Day, and now be with us throughout this week, that as we go, we will be a light in this dark world, and that we will be about the work of sharing the wonderful, life-saving, soul-changing gospel of Jesus Christ. We pray this in the wonderful and powerful name of Jesus. Amen.